Tony Zhang, special guest from China. Tony is the senior vice president of Tiandu. Also, he's the president of Tiandu Technology Strategy Board. He is also the general manager of Automatic Drive Business Unit. Today, he will bring his view on artificial intelligence and pilotless driving. After Tony's speech, there will be a Q&A session. Feel free to ask any questions you like. Mr. Zhang, stage is yours. Thank you.
今天 AI 已经达到一个什么样的水准呢？就是说，人类在安静的环境下，我们的语音识别率是在98%，这是对于人类而言，这是我们人类的平均水准。那我们千度这个语音识别在安静环境下，标准普通话它可以达到97%，离人类只有一步之遥。而在这个噪音环境下啊，比如说车载环境下，它也有92%，这已经是一个非常高的水准了。不过我们千度从来不会满足于现状，因为科学的进步是无止境的，所以我们这个技术仍然在不断进步，希望未来能够超越人类。再来就是视的方面，图像识别。有时候我们人类都很难辨别出这是不是同样一个人，但是计算机可以帮我们人类更好的来识别人的脸。在 LFW 人脸测试当中，我们千度已经达到了全球的最高水平，世界第一，它的错误率只有0.23%，而人类的错误率是0.8%，接近于三倍多的这样一个错误率。而这个图像识别它还能够帮助计算机进行行为预判，就是说它还能够看文字。最重要的是什么？你给它一张图，它就能够判断这个图到底是什么意思，然后再进行一个行为预判。那这对于无人驾驶来说是非常重要的。我们再来看一下自动驾驶汽车的八大模块，大家可以看到，视觉、环境感知、规划决策、自动控制、传感器的融合、语音对话、高精定位以及是高精地图，这是八大技术模块。这些都是我们千度多年投入多年关注多年的一个大方向。从我们高科技企业来看，未来的汽车你可以把它看成是在四个轮子上面的一台电脑。为什么这样说呢？未来的汽车它主要的能力是由其 AI 所决定的。今年年初，摩根斯坦利做了一个预估，就是说未来的汽车它60%的价值是来自于软件，而不是它传统的汽车这个部分。那么这个和我们高科技企业的看法是不谋而合的，可以说是英雄所见略同。那今天的汽车，尤其是无人驾驶汽车，它里头有三个核心模块，其实它跟这个人工智能是有这个 consistency 的。第一呢，它驾驶的算法，这是第一点。然后另外一个就是计算能力，这个计算能力可以分为两个部分，它80%的计算能力是储存在云端，而20%是是在汽车里头的。那第三个呢，其实是非常关键的，就是说我们千度这个汽车收集来的这些数据，就是 big data。当我们一辆车开出去以后，我们就会把收集来的这个数据上传到数据中心，然后这个data center 再把所有的车的数据收集到一起进行学习，它其实就像那个驾校一样，你可以看到它可以看到每辆车所遇到的一个场景，并且在特定场景之下，它会采取什么样的措施，怎么处理。今天我们每一辆无人驾驶汽车相当于都配了一个人。如果我们部署了10万辆汽车出去，每辆车一年开20000公里，大家可以做一个快速的算数，10万乘以20000等于多少？这一年，我们所累积的数据就是21公里。这些会上传到数据中心， 我们会对它进行一个分类、筛选，并且汇总。所以到了最后呢，每辆车都成为了开过21公里的老司机。我们说在无人驾驶或者是 AI 这个时代呢，真的就是快鱼吃慢鱼，先到先得。谁的动作更快，谁能更好的保障安全性，谁就能更快的、更好的将无人驾驶汽车带到社会。我们在过去，这个高精地图的精度它已经达到了10cm 这样的一个级别。那我们千度已经更进一步，已经达到了厘米1cm 这样的数量级，是中国最高的。另外一个就是高精定位，就是说我们人类开车是不用知道经纬度的，但是无人驾驶它需要知道自己在哪个点上因为这样它才可以做这个道路规划、驾驶规划以及其他的一些判断。我们的目标就是在3年之内实现在中国实现商用，在5年之内实现量产。那么大家都知道，在中国汽车交通安全是一个很大的问题。我们每天据这个数据显示，每天中国有超过500人是死于交通事故而我们千度会运用先进的技术研发出这个无人汽车这可以提高汽车的安全性，大大降低死亡率。好，我的演讲到此结束，谢谢。
Thank you. That was Tony Zhang, Senior Vice President of Chengdu. And let's proceed to our Q&A session. If you have any question, feel free to ask Tony. Please.
I have a question actually. I wonder, like, if in the future, inevitably, if the self-driving cars cause any traffic accidents, so who should be blamed? The human, the driver, or the car? Thank you.
Okay, 我就用中文回答吧。首先非常谢谢这位女士的提问。我认为虽然说现在交通事故仍然还没做到完全根绝的地步，但是我们千度以及我们的各个同行会对这个缺陷进行不断的 improve 不断的 improvement 会出现。然后我认为到了最后整个它这个死亡率将会大大降低。
I have a question that before these automatic driving cars officially goes to the road, should they get to pass a test like the drivers, or they just pass the examination from the companies or the road testers? Thank you.
好，谢谢。我们会做两方面的测试。首先，这个是。就是我们的 internal test， 就是我们在这个推出进入市场之前，我们会做一个各方面的性能测试，然后我们也会做一个比较模拟的，就是说有人驾驶的这样的一个测试，就是说两方面齐头并进，就是双管齐下。
Do we have any more questions? Okay, thank you again, Tony, for sharing your insight on the application of artificial intelligence from a commercial perspective. And Tony just now mentioned the concept of machine learning, and that's exactly the topic of our next speaker, Alma Dre. Alma Dre, a senior data scientist of Kaggle. Before joining Kaggle, Al-Madri worked as a senior data analyst at Intel. So please join me in welcoming our final speaker of this morning, Al-Madri.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're happy it's finally the end of the morning. I hope you are not bored enough to listen to all the AI speeches. And as our previous speakers have made excellent speeches about AI opportunities and positive sides, I share a lot with them, but I also like to raise some concerns over it. And I would like to start by telling you guys of its development. It used to be that if you want a computer to do something new, you would like to program it. Now, programming. For those of you here haven't done it before, it requires laying out excruciating details of single steps that you want the computer to do to achieve your goal. Now, if you want the computer to do something that you don't know how to do it, that's going to be a big challenge for you. So this was the challenge faced by this man, as our speaker also have mentioned before, Earth Example. In 1956, he wanted to get this computer to be better than him and beat him in the checkers. So how could you write a program, lay out in excruciating details to be better than you at checkers? So he came up with the idea. He had this computer to play with itself a thousand of times and to learn how to play checkers. And indeed it worked. And in fact, by 1962, this computer had beaten the Connecticut state champion. So Arthur Samuel was the father of machine learning, and I have a great debt to him because I'm a machine learning practitioner. I'm a senior data scientist of Kaggle, a community of over 200,000 machine learning practitioners. Kaggle puts out competitions to try and to get them to solve the previously unsolved problems, and it's been successful for hundreds of times. So from this vantage point, I'm able to figure out a lot about what machine learning can do in the past, can do in the present, and what it could do in the future. Perhaps the first big success of machine learning commercially was Google. Google showed that it is possible to find information by using a computer algorithm, and this algorithm is based on machine learning. Companies like Amazon's and Netflix, they use machine learning to suggest products you might like to buy and movies you might like to watch. And you have no idea how he did it. And this is because it's using the power of machine learning. These are algorithms that have learned how to do this from data rather than being programmed by hand. This is also how IBM was successful in getting Watson to beat the two world champions at Jeopardy, answering incredibly subtle and complex questions like this. And as our speaker also mentioned this before, it was incredible. So this is also why we are now able to see the first self-driving cars, as our previous speaker talked about their invention. If you want to be able to tell the differences between, say, a pedestrian and a tree, well, that's pretty important. We cannot do it before because we didn't know how to write programs about it. But now it's possible because of machine learning. This car has driven over a million miles without any accidents on regular roads. So now we know that computers can learn. And computers can learn to do things that we sometimes actually don't know how to do ourselves, or even do them better than us. One of the most amazing examples I've seen of machine learning happened on the project at Kaggle, where a team run by a guy called Jeffrey Hinton. He's from the University of Toronto, and they won a competition of automatic drug discovery. Now, what was extraordinary here was not just that they beat all the algorithms developed by Merck's or international academic community, but none of the team members had a background in biology, chemistry, or life sciences. And they did it in 2 weeks. So how did they do that? They used an extraordinary algorithm called deep learning. So important was this that this success was covered in the New York Times a front page article 2 weeks later. And deep learning is an algorithm inspired by how human brain works. So as a result, and it's an algorithm that has no theoretical limitations on what it can do, because the more data you give it, the more computation time you give it, the better it gets. The New York Times has also showed in this article another extraordinary result of deep learning, which I'm going to show you now. It shows that computers can listen and understand.
Now, the last step that I want to be able to take in this process is to actually speak to you in Chinese. Now, the key thing there is we've been able to take a large amount of information from many Chinese speakers and produce a text-to-speech system that takes Chinese text and converts it into Chinese language. And then we've taken an hour or so of my own voice, and we've used that to modulate the standard text-to-speech system so that it would sound like me. So what you see now is the result of that change. I'm speaking in